Good morning and hallelujah. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. What Sunday is this? The second Sunday after Pentecost. This is, we are in proper season. That's what I was looking for. This is the season where we transition into the second half of the church calendar, and it's the year that we focus on the church and the growth of the church and bringing about the church in God's kingdom. And so this morning, it is good to be together in the house of the Lord, to worship together. Your bulletin is available on the post, and you can download it there to follow along. But we begin on page 355. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Be with you and also with you. Let us pray. Keep, O Lord, your household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion. For the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now let us take some time and tune our hearts to the reading of God's Holy Scripture.
The first reading is from Exodus chapter 19. The Israelites had journeyed from Rephidim, entered the wilderness of Sinai, and camped in the wilderness. Israel camped there in front of the mountain. Then Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, saying, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob, and tell the Israelites, you have seen what I did to the Egyptians, and how I bore you on eagle's wings, and brought you to myself. Now therefore, if you obey my voice, and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation. These are the words that you shall speak to the Israelites." So Moses came, summoned the elders of the people, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has said, we shall do." The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 100. Be joyful in the Lord, all you lands. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his presence with a song. Know this, the Lord himself is God. He himself has made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving, go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and call upon his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his faithfulness endures from age to age. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The second reading is from Romans chapter 5. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to our Lord Jesus, to this grace in which we stand, and we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us. Because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us, for while we were still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. And then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles: first, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, the son of Zebedee, and his brother John, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew the tax collector, James son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, Simon the Cananean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You received without payment, give without payment. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Since then, we are justified by faith. We have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Has anyone ever said anything about you that you thought just wasn't true? And I'm not talking about somebody being evil or purposely hateful or anything like that. I'm just talking about the feeling of simply being misunderstood. Have you ever felt misunderstood? But then as you talked it through, you begin to realize that, well, maybe this person has a point. Or not. I mean, maybe you stick to your guns and put up your defenses and refuse to listen, and maybe even to the point of completely closing your ears to reason. I read the gospel and I wonder how the crowd would have felt if Jesus said out loud, "My disciples, look at these people. I mean, look at them. They're helpless. They're hopeless. They're like sheep without a shepherd." My point in this little rhetorical exercise is this. Do you actually think that the people felt lost? I mean, did they think that they were helpless and harassed like sheep without a shepherd? I guarantee not. And yet, that was Jesus' evaluation of them. How often do we think that we have our act together just to find out later that we didn't? And we actually didn't have a clue. I think a lot about teenagers. Or when in your first years of college, you know, you think you know it all. You're going to tackle the world. Or prospective first-time parents. Now, no offense to any, no offense intended to any upcoming first-time parents. You know, I love you. You're doing great. You're going to be wonderful, but you just don't have a clue. And it's okay. As I grow older, the more I realize I don't have it all together. I mean, not as an individual, not as a parent, not as a husband, not as a pastor. I mean, I could go on. And the thing with this whole sheep without a shepherd part of the gospel is, most often, we think it applies to them out there. It doesn't apply to us. We think they're the ones that are the sheep without a shepherd. But we actually have our act together. And the reality is, it applies to all of us. We are all sheep in need of a shepherd at any point in our lives. And so here's the thing. We must sit up and take notice. We must listen to what Jesus is going to say. I mean, here they are. He says, they are sheep without a shepherd. And so the next thing he says is the key. It's this pregnant pause. It's time to rally the troops. And somebody needs to step up and take leadership. Somebody needs to guide them in what they need to do. We need to organize. We need to incorporate. We need to politicize. We need to develop a creed. We need to. And what is Jesus' answer? He commissions those around him to go. He says, the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Now, first of all, here's an analogy that everyone can understand, at least in that time. I mean, they were still an agrarian culture. There were crops, and there were crop cycles. There were harvests that needed to be brought in, and there were feasts that coincided with the beginning and the ends of the harvest. This was not some abstract metaphor. These people knew what it took to bring in the harvest. Some of them had experienced it themselves. Jesus was calling them to hard, backbreaking work. But what were they supposed to do? What kind of work was this harvest? Was Jesus calling them to organize the people? Was he calling them to raise an army, to rally the troops? No, because this would be a harvest of souls. And Jesus' answer to the needs of these helpless, hapless people was to call on his disciples to begin to deliver en masse the good news of the kingdom. It's this good news, it's this gospel news that was Jesus' purpose, and he knew that it would change their lives. See, this good news of the kingdom business, this is how the passage starts. Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom. He then commissions the disciples explicitly to proclaim the good news that the kingdom of heaven has come near. The kingdom of heaven, and not this kingdom on earth that they anticipated. And by the way, he didn't preach kingdom exclusive of the people's needs. I mean, he healed their sicknesses. He healed their diseases. And he gave the disciples the authority to cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, and even cast out demons. But as we find out through the rest of the gospel, all of this was for the purpose of validating the message of the coming kingdom of Christ. The answer that he gives is the gospel. First and foremost, the goal of the laborers of the harvest was to call people to repentance and faith in Christ. And Jesus saw that they were spiritually lost, without someone to guide them, without someone to shepherd their souls. See, his perspective was way different than theirs. They likely thought that they had all their stuff together. And what they needed was to be free from Rome. What they needed was a new king like David that would take up the sword and lead them to victory over their oppressors. You see, what they really needed was for someone to lead them back into fellowship with God. That's really what was at work here. And this is true to this day. And Jesus calls everyone, everywhere, including us, to repentance and faith in Christ. And then Paul explains why this is so important in the Romans passage. It's because this is the only path to peace with God. I mentioned earlier that the older I get, the realize how little I have it together. And for many of us, though, it's easy to take that and to beat ourselves up for not being enough, not doing enough, not living up to the impossible standards that we set for ourselves. And then the circumstances of life end up offering us very little peace. Sometimes we let the discord of a fallen world invade our hearts. I mean, we look around and we see no peace around us, and we take that angst into our own hearts and we become troubled. We lose sight of Christ and we place it on the world and everything that's going on around us. We let the anxiousness of society burrow deep into our souls and rob us of peace. Or sometimes we reach the point, like Paul did, in Romans chapter 7. Don't worry, we're going to get to this in a few weeks, where he says, there is nothing good that dwells within me. Wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Like Paul, sometimes the reality of our own sin comes crashing in and robs us of peace. Paul reinforces the fact that in this life we will suffer. In this upside down world, though, in this upside down world where Christian faith looks different than what we expect, we're supposed to actually boast in our suffering. See, it's a wonder we have any peace at all in this life. And this is exactly what Paul is getting to. It's why he reminds us that peace, true peace, comes from standing before God, justified through Christ. True peace comes from God. It's through peace and grace. True peace comes from God through grace when we stand before Him, justified in Christ, restored to fellowship through the death of Jesus. See, in all of these instances that I've mentioned of being harassed and helpless and feeling without a shepherd, Paul says this is exactly when and where Christ comes to redeem us. See, Jesus died for us while we were weak. And let's not get confused about this word here. This is not weak as in I'm recovering from some sickness and I just need to get a little bit of food in me. The word is powerless, and it's powerless in the face of an omnipotent God. Jesus dies for us because we are utterly incapable of saving ourselves. Paul also says that Christ died while we were sinners. See, the hope we have in a world of brokenness, hardship, suffering, sinfulness, and definitely no peace is that Christ came and died. And see, he didn't die for us because we had all our stuff together. He died expressly because we don't. See, God's divine love isn't for the almost saved. It isn't for those people who mostly deserve it. It's not for those who need just a little extra push into righteousness. His love is for those who are dead, for those who are powerless to save, for those who are wretched sinners, those who are absolutely undeserving of his love. That's all of us. And Jesus came in the midst of that brokenness, in the midst of that weakness, in the midst of our sin and our pain, and he dies for us. And then through faith in him, that death becomes our justification before God. And since we are justified by faith, we can find peace, true peace, lasting peace. It's only here that our souls will rest. See, as the disciples went out, more and more people began to respond to his call of repentance. And as people began to respond to Christ, then their priorities began to change. This desire to topple Rome and reestablish the kingdom of Israel, that began to wane. So their hope became less and less about what this world could offer and more about what was promised in the next. See, in Paul's words, they began to boast in a future where they would share, where they would participate in God's glory. And we see this in Acts specifically. Followers of Christ begin to see the world through Jesus' eyes. See, becoming sheep and following the true shepherd means that we trust in what he is accomplishing, both in the world and in us. And placing our faith in him is how we ultimately find our place in this life. This is the only space where true and lasting peace may be found. May we long for that peace in Christ as we walk in faith and are justified through Him. Amen. As we do relish in the peace that has been given us through our Savior, Jesus Christ, we have an opportunity to confess together the faith that we believe, as it is formulated in the Nicene Creed, found on page 358 and also in your bulletins on page 4. Please join me. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through Him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, He came down from heaven, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, He became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, He was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. And on the third day, He rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and His kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, He is worshipped and glorified, and He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
First, the people followed Form 3. Please recite if you want to responsibly. Father, we pray for your one holy Catholic Church, that we all may be one. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you, that your name may be glorified by all people. We pray for Michael Curry, our presiding bishop, Gregory Brewer, our bishop, Father Rob, our rector, Church of the Province of Myanmar, Burma, and Bishop Stephen Van Mint, St. Albans Church, Auburndale, and Reverend John Gullett, Church of the Redeemer, Avon Park, and Reverend William Yates, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons, that they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments. We pray for Donald Trump, Governor Ron DeSantis, Mayor Brian Nelson, and for all who govern and uphold authority in the nations of the world, that there may be justice and peace on the earth. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake, that our works may find favor in your sight. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble, that they may be delivered from their distress. Give to the departed, especially Nanette Taylor, eternal rest. Let light perpetual shine upon them. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. And now, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you into eternal life. Amen. And now, may God's peace through Christ reign upon you and give you grace. Peace of the Lord be always with you and also with you. So at this time, we are going to take a break. We're going to go ahead and wash up and prepare for the Eucharist service. And so we will be back in about a minute. Well, again, welcome, and thank you so much for joining us this morning at Church of the Holy Spirit here in Apopka, Florida. If this is your first time that you come into our live stream, welcome. We're really glad that you joined us today. We have been doing live stream only for a few months now, and so we're glad that you're here. If you're joining us for the first time, please go ahead and just drop a comment. We would love to see your name and hear where you're from so we can just say thank you. We obviously won't be able to send you anything or spam you or anything like that, so go ahead, feel free to leave a comment. If you have questions or anything that you would like to ask about the service, go ahead and put them there, and then we'll respond to you in a little bit. Following this service at 10:30, we are continuing to do drive-through Eucharist. So if you are local and you would like to partake of the service that we will be blessing this morning, then please come around 10:30. We are located at 601 South Highland Avenue in Apopka, right downtown. We're easy to find. We're at the corner of 6th Avenue and Highland. If you do come down, please enter on the Highland Avenue side, down by the Youth House. Come up to the front of the sanctuary, and then you'll exit on the 6th Street. And of course, stay in your car. This is drive-through. We will serve you in your car, so just come on up, and we'll serve you there. We continue to have morning prayer live on Monday, Wednesday, Friday, right here on Facebook Live at 9 a.m. Eastern Time. And so if you would like to join us, please do. I usually post links to the texts and to the service and all of that. So if you're unfamiliar, if you've never done morning prayer before and you're just kind of wondering what that's like, sign on and we'll walk you through it. And it takes about 20 to 25 minutes. And it's a good time for opening up our hearts in prayer in the morning. As you go through your day and as you focus on this, the Lord's Day, spend some time in music. You know, we've had choruses and a hymn or two in the service here, but it's not quite the same as being in the sanctuary. So find your favorite hymn CD or Pandora station or whatever it is, and spend a little bit of time listening and joining in praises, and that would be good for your heart as well. Okay, so everybody's been waiting for this announcement, and really the details to confirm it have just really yesterday came together. So the pieces have all come together, and we can start in sanctuary services next weekend on the 21st. So everybody clap, take some time. Clap, say yay, hallelujah, throw a hallelujah in the comments, because I know we've all been looking forward to this. There are caveats. Well, let me explain the parameters first. So we will keep this time slot because there are many of you who still desire to stay home and should stay home. And so I encourage you to go ahead and stay home, you know, as long as you need to. So what we're going to do is we're going to start temporarily with one service. We're going to do one service at 9 a.m. in the sanctuary, and then we will have the drive-through Eucharist. We'll probably be closer to 11 a.m., and we need a bigger space to allow people to exit the parking lot after the service. So service here at 9 a.m., drive through your Eucharist at 11 a.m. Please come out for that if you are electing to stay at home, and that is totally fine. I will continue that at least into the fall, and I'm committed. If there's five of you that still want to stay home and partake of Eucharist, then I'll be here for you for that. The caveats are, as you can imagine, we are not free to just come one, come all, and go back to the way we were. We're not there yet. The Diocese of Central Florida has laid specific guidelines that we, as a member of this diocese, must adhere to. So when you come, masks will be required for all people, including the clergy. I will take it off when I preach and when I celebrate. So masks will be required for all who come. And so that, for some of you, that's a good enough reason to stay home, and that is okay. No judgment at all in that. Masks will be required, social distancing. I wish I could show you the sanctuary, but it's been sufficiently marked off where you will know where you can sit and where you cannot sit. So we will be enforcing social distancing. And I do want to encourage you that if you are in any way concerned about the virus is still out there. And with the last few weeks of gatherings, we're likely to see a spike in cases of the coronavirus. So if you are a person who are most vulnerable, please do stay home. It is okay. It is quite all right. Stay home. You know who you are. Don't feel responsible like you have to come. This live stream will continue. And Lord willing, this is going to be a permanent thing. It's going to look different because we're in the process of getting things set up where we have a permanent fixture in the back of the sanctuary. So if you could see everything that's surrounding the altar now to make this work, you'd be like, oh, we won't be able to see Father Rob at all. So that all is going to change. So this will continue, and I will continue with drive-through Eucharist. Okay. And then the other thing is I'm going to send out an email, hopefully by tomorrow is my goal, to have a lot more specifics. But the biggest thing are the masks and the social distancing. So next week, June 21st, we are back together. I can't wait to see your smiling eyes, because I won't be able to see your whole face, because each one of you will be wearing a mask. All right, good. I think that's it. I feel like there's so much more to say. I can't wait to see you. But as we begin our Eucharist service, our offertory sentences, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and a sacrifice to God. Before we begin our service, I'd just like to remind us that this is the Lord's table. It's not the church's table. It's not my table. This is Christ offering himself to us. And as such, if you are a baptized believer in Jesus Christ, the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, if you belong to any denomination, You are welcome to this table. If you're local, again, we have drive-thru Eucharist after this service at 10:30. Please come. Please join us. We would love to have you here. The Lord be with you and also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give him thanks and praise. It is right and a good and a joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty Father, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made for us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and to die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And we celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension. We offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. The gifts of God are the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts through faith and with thanksgiving. Now using the form on page 365 and also on page 9 in your bulletin, let us pray the post-communion prayer. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. And you have fed us with the spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now using the same Trinitarian blessing that we did last week. May God, the Holy Trinity, make you strong in faith and love, defend you on every side, and guide you in the truth and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you now and remain with you always. Amen. Now let us go forth into the world rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to God.
One, two, three. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, hear we your unworthy servants give you humble thanks. For you are good and full of loving kindness, pouring pouring out your love to us and all whom you have made. We bless you, Lord, for our creation, preservation, and the blessings of this life. But most of the world by Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and the hope of glory. And give us such awareness of your mercies that we truly thankful hearts we may show for your praise. Not only with our lips but in our whole lives, giving up ourselves to serve you, walking in your ways. In holiness and righteousness, all of our days and his people. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of bondage. You shall have no other gods but me. Shall not make for yourself any idol.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
You shall not invoke with malice the name of the Lord your God.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy.
Amen, Lord, have mercy.
Again to